And thank you very much for accepting our paper to this wonderful presentation leading by Journal of International Economics, Central Bank of Chile, and the Research Department at the IDB. It's fantastic to put all these leading institutions and journals together. So thank you again. So this is a joint paper with Diego Rojas, with Carlos Vega, Diego from the World Bank and University of Maryland, Carlos now at Hopkins and MBER. So as Pablo was saying, mostly it's going to be an empirical paper. It's about what is the impact of macroprudential policy on the macroeconomics. A lot of what we have been discussing yesterday and today has been around, there were some empirical papers at the very beginning, and then we switched towards the mechanisms that are at work when you have capital controls, the mechanisms at work when you have financial frictions, the mechanism at work when you have macroprudential policy. So this paper is going to be mostly empirical, and it's going to try to make the case that it's very important in macroeconomics, especially in the empirical front, to measure things correctly, and most importantly, to identify properly shocks. So let me go a little bit through the roadmap of the presentation. I'm going to first talk a little bit, because this is a great audience, there's not that much need for that. We're going to talk a little bit about the motivation and the sneak peek of our results. Then I'm going to switch towards the main ingredient, the reserve requirement data. It's going to be our main right-hand side variable, so to speak. Then I'm going to show you what would happen if you use traditional identification strategies. And by traditional, maybe I would say old, in the sense that they are not so frontier ones, but it's the one that many cases we typically work around. And I think some of the papers that were presented yesterday have some sort of approach in that line. Then I'm going to show you the new measures to identify proper shocks. In particularly, as describing the title, most of the effort is going to be around the reserve requirement shock, but we're also going to take a deeper look into the central bank interest rate shock. And then I'm going to, once I show you this, I'm going to show you again what would happen if you show the evidence, if you try to see what are the implications of these properly identified shocks on the macroeconomy and see how they change, and they change a lot, believe me. So, motivation and sneak peek of our findings. Big picture, we have been talking about this a lot. There's an intense debate of the pros and cons of using macroprudential policy for stabilization purposes, for credit purposes, for different type of macroeconomic purposes broadly defined. There is a huge and growing theoretical literature. Many of the authors that I put here are either in the selection committee, authors, presenters. So this is exactly sort of the ideal audience in this sense. But when you take a look at the empirical front, most of the time there is not that much evidence, or at least there is no solid consensus on what are the implications of macroprudential policy on economic activity, for example. And this is mostly because of two well-known problems. One is the issue of data, and the second one is the issue of identification. So the papers that are out there, they typically focus on the empirical front, on the impact of macroprudential policy on domestic credit conditions, but still there is a lot of debate on whether that effect is as expected by models or not. And the other one is, if you look around, not just the credit market, but most broadly, the issue of economic impact, broadly defined GDP or things like that, it is even less known the case. So this is, I would say, this is a paper that focuses on the identification issue, but it builds around a paper that we brought with Carlos and Pablo Federico, where what we mostly did was to create a novel data set on macroprudential policies, and in particular, we look on reserve requirements data. Why? Because it's relatively well used, especially in emerging markets. We document that in the previous paper. It's easier, so to speak, to identify this type of data as opposed to other more recent or more specific type of data that might be less global in terms of its comprehensive scope. So what we did in that paper was to put together 52 countries dating back to the 1970s. And what we did was to find, to gather this legal reserve requirement data. And the reason why we wanted to focus on the legal is because it's a policy instrument as opposed to reserve requirements itself, which is an endogenous response considering both the legal and the functioning of the credit market. And what we did in that paper was to show in a very less sophisticated way, if I may, that reserve requirements behave contracyclically in the sense that when output falls, reserve requirement also falls. And this tends to go against what we typically see on the interest rate front. Typically, central banks, when there is capital outflows, when there are negative terms of trade shocks, basically when the economy is in a bad shape and output goes down and you have pressures towards depreciation and so on and so forth, typically what central banks do with monetary policies to increase the interest rate. That is not what we observe with reserve requirements. What we observe is that in that sense, reserve requirements work the other way around. And this is typically what we would get if we focus on the three samples that we have in this paper, which is Argentina, Brazil, and Uruguay. What would happen if you shock these terms of trade, for example, which is a typical external factor affecting output fluctuations? A lot of the authors and of the papers today and yesterday and organizers have worked a lot around these issues of the implications of terms of trade on output volatility. Typically, what you would find is that the positive terms of trade shock would increase GDP. If the shock was negative, a negative terms of trade would reduce GDP. If you have a negative terms of trade, you would have pressures towards depreciation, pressures towards inflation, pressures towards an increase in the central bank interest rate if the terms of trade was negative, and the other way around in terms of the effect on reserve requirements. So based on that former paper, what you would have is that central bank interest would act procyclically and reserve requirements would act contracyclically. But again, this is not the focus of this paper. This paper is about the other implication in terms of not how fiscal policy responds to output fluctuations, but rather what is the implication in this case of reserve requirement policy on output. So what is what we propose to do for this paper? Well, we are going to use one particular type of macroprudential policy, which is this legal reserve requirement. And again, I want to emphasize the legal aspect is if we use the actual reserve requirement that would be contaminated by other things that are endogenous to the economic functioning. So we focus on the legal aspect that we borrow from this other paper. One improvement that we did with respect to that paper that is more comprehensive is also to make a lot of effort to focus to get the data on composition of deposits, so we can actually calculate the legal reserve requirement as we had, but also the effective reserve requirements. And we can sort of decompose to what extent the actual reserve requirement is changing because of legal issues and because of changes in the composition of domestic deposits. But not importantly, what we do in this paper is we push the frontier on the identification of exogenous shocks. And what we did here, and some of you might know that we come a lot also from the fiscal front, is to use a narrative approach for changes in legal reserve requirements a la Romer-Romer 2010. For those of you who remember that very nice paper, seminal paper, what Romer-Romer did in that paper was to identify tax changes, which somehow behave like reserve requirements in the sense that they are sporadic changes in a policy instrument that you can very narrowly identify and understand. And what they did in that paper was to take a look at the underlying motivation of policymakers to change those tax changes. Here, we sort of borrow that technique that has been quite successful and quite influential in the fiscal front, and we bring it back to this reserve requirement literature. So what I'm going to show you later is, after identifying the changes in reserve requirement, how is that we go through a lot of documents to try to understand what is really going on behind each of those changes. And on the monetary front, on the interest rate policy, what we did was also borrow from another paper of Romer-Romer. Remember that central bank policy changed, and here we have many central people working on the central bank, so I don't have to make the case that strongly. It's a variable that changes much more often. So what basically Romer-Romer did there was to try to identify all changes in interest rates for the United States in their paper and try to suck up all the variability in that policy rate that is driven by either contemporaneous or lagged economic variables or forecasted changes in inflation, in growth, in different variables that typically central bankers look around to try to change policy rates. In that way, one would suck up all the anticipated effect coming from changes in central bank interest rates. So we're going to do something like that on our front with these emerging markets countries. Basically, these three Latin American countries, Argentina, Brazil, and Uruguay, starting in the late 1990s. And what is it we found, spoiler alert, is very simple. If you take a look at the impact of reserve requirement changes on GDP, without doing this effort of identification, what you would get is that the effect would be either zero, which goes against some of the most traditional models in macro, or we would find that this result is even positive, which I think some of the results from yesterday morning went around that direction too. Now, if you identify this properly after doing this narrative effort, what you get is exactly the opposite, which is what one would expect from the theory, that increases in reserve requirements would reduce economic activity, and then I'm going to show you the mechanism working through the credit market. So let me move now to the reserve requirement data. This is how the data looks like. This is the legal reserve requirements data for Argentina, for Brazil, and this is for Uruguay. As you see, there are different legal rates that changes over time. And this very much depends when moving from an advanced economy to emerging markets. They vary not only among the issue of maturity, being higher with a short-term maturity, but it also changes in terms of currency. So you have, in the case of Argentina, all these six legal reserve requirements, as in Brazil, being different not only in terms of term, but also in terms of local or foreign currency. In our sample, we have a lot of variation. We have in Argentina almost 50 changes, in Brazil 30, in Uruguay 13, for a total of 93 changes in reserve requirements. So on average, based on our sample, there is one change in reserve requirements every 10 months, which is pretty good. Again, this is taking into account all the changes in reserve requirements. Just borrowing from our previous paper on another issue, on average in emerging markets, the reserve requirement changes once every 2 years. So these countries show much more frequency of variation. And if you take a look at industrial countries, they rarely change. They change once every 12 years, which suggests that industrial economies maybe use interest rates more as a monetary policy tool as opposed to reserve requirements in the way emerging markets do. Of course, in order to have these two policy tools, you would need some imperfect substitution between assets. There's a very nice paper by Carlos and Alahiri on this. So in the paper, we discuss a lot, not only the source of the data and how we did it, but some basic long-run properties and short-run properties. If you take a look, for example, at the mean and the standard deviation of these reserve requirements, one of the features that emerges very nicely and is consistent with a big literature on financial repression is that when you move from earlier periods, and needless to say, if you go to the 80s, it's even more the case, you have, over time, large reductions in reserve requirements, moving from values in the case of Brazil, like 50, to more global levels, to 20 or 20-something percent. The other main long-run feature is that over time, as central banks learn how to deal with problems of balance sheets in firms and different type of and balance sheets in banks, and learn how to improve the sophistication and the resilience of the financial sector, then you are able to reduce some of those reserve requirements. And what you tend to see is a reduction in the dispersion of those reserve requirements over time. So these are some of the long-run properties that we describe in the paper. It is also interesting to know that in spite of having different levels, these reserve requirements, they tend to be highly synchronized at the quarterly frequency. This is a table that shows for each of these countries the correlation of different type of reserve requirement, legal reserve requirements over time. And what you see is that in all cases, they are positive. And most of the time, they are very highly synchronized. In some cases, they are less, but most of the time, they're highly synchronized. So what is the actual measure that we construct for this paper? Well, the first one that we construct is what we call the effective reserve requirement, which is basically the product of the reserve requirement times the weight that type of deposit has in the structure of the portfolio of bank deposits. But similarly to what happens with the average marginal income tax rate on the tax front, a lot of the changes in this effective reserve requirement could change either because of policy reasons, like the reserve requirement, legal reserve requirement, or it could also change because the weight is changing. So in order to avoid this contamination coming from endogenous responses of the structure of deposits, precisely to changes in reserve requirements, what we use effectively in our empirical study is what we call the effective constant reserve requirement, which is basically the legal reserve requirement weighted by the historical weight of that particular type of deposit. Another option could have been use the weight of the previous quarter, like someone on the fiscal front would do. The results are fairly consistent across different specifications. Okay, so this is the data we have. What would have happened if we had used the regular approach of using, for example, the panel VAR using a time identification strategy? We would have get the typical result that increases in interest rate policies reduce output. Interestingly, when we move to changes in effective constant reserve requirements using all changes, all legal changes, we don't have that. We have basically a zero positive result. What would have happened if instead of using that time identification strategy where we allow a lag coming from the policy to output, what would have happened if we instead use local projections and if we allow the changes in reserve requirement or changes in interest rate policy to currently contemporaneously affect output? On the interest rate side, we would have gotten a similar result. See that now you have a quarter zero. So we allow now changes in policy to change output contemporaneously, but still on the reserve requirements front, we don't get any response as expected negative. So this is actually the source of our motivation for the paper. So as I told you before, what we do is a narrative-based identification, like Romer-Romer. Basically what you do here is you go to each of those changes, you try to identify sources that describe why policymakers were doing these changes. Most of these sources are IMF reports, central bank reports, newspapers of the time where they discuss what the policymaker had in mind. And basically when we have all this information, and it's a lot of work, we have to read a lot, to each of those changes in reserve requirements, we assign a categorization, either endogenous or exogenous. Endogenous in the sense that the policy change was mainly driven by the intention to offset current or projected developments in the economy. This is the case of many financial stress situations where policymakers increase the rates, like Argentina did in the tequila, decreases in reserve requirements as Argentina did after the tequila, or sometimes when you have a sudden capital outflow. So these are the type of changes that are driven either by economic, macroeconomic GDP triggers, or by capital flows triggers. And then those of those changes who are mostly driven by long-term considerations like financial liberalizations, as I showed you before, there's a long-term trend reduction in the reserve requirements. So one of the categories that we have is in terms of exogenous are these financial liberalizations. In some other cases, changes in reserve requirements are changes to improve the financial intermediation. Those changes, we call them microprudential purposes. And there are also some changes which are not the poster child, but they are at least less short-term macroeconomic GDP related ones are related to liquidity regulations. So after doing all this work, after reading all these tons of papers and tons of documents, what we do, after being very much tired of reading a lot, we're able to classify and split these total changes into exogenous and endogenous categories. Out of the 93 changes, we have 62 that are classified as exogenous and 31 that are classified as endogenous. That we're not going to take them into account in order to properly identify a reserve requirement shock. And out of those exogenous, here is a split between financial liberalization, liquidity regulation, and microprudential. One of the things that we do in the paper is we also take one at a time to see if there is some particular effect coming from one particular type of changes on those exogenous ones, and we don't get anything interesting. So after doing this big effort on the reserve requirement front, we go also in terms of identifying central banks' interest rate shocks. And we do, again, in a spirit that Romer-Romer, we don't have the rich data Romer-Romer had in terms of the data that was available by the Fed at the time of making the decisions. Here we use IMF forecasts using different vintages. So we run something that is similar in that sense. And basically what we do, as the equation there shows, is we try to identify all the lag determinants of changes in interest rates and all the forecasted changes in key macroeconomic variables. And what we do is, in order to capture this interest rate shock, is to use the residual of that equation. And once we do that, what we do is we go again, we take Korda's approach, local projection, and we run regressions. And this is the key difference, is that in here, you would have as the main shock, something that has been classified based on our strategy, the narrative approach, as exogenous, and in terms of the Romer-Romer 2004, the interest rate, the part of the interest rate that has been classified as exogenous. And what we find is, on the interest rate side, identifying proper interest rate shocks does not change much of the situation, the result, as I will hint later, because most of these results are procyclical, but where there is a big change is on the impact of reserve requirements that are now, through this narrative approach, classified as exogenous on GDP. We find negative results, which is what we all had in mind, in the sense that increases in reserve requirements tends to reduce output. Why is that that happened? Some of the things that we do in the paper is to understand a little bit better the mechanism. And in both cases, as one would expect, both increases in interest rates and increases in reserve requirements increase the interest rate spread. So the main channel through which this macroeconomic effect is occurring is, as expected, through the functioning of the credit system. Okay. So one of the efforts that we do in the paper, and you know, after doing all the identification effort, one needs to do something else, to try to reconcile our previous findings where reserve requirements didn't find. Remember, at the very beginning, when I show you the traditional evidence, we had no effect coming from reserve requirement changes. But now, once we had identified with exogenous changes, as in here, we found that it is negative. So what is going on? And what we found was going on is precisely this. So here, what we do is an experiment where we, and this is wrong, but we do it just to see what are the implications of doing things wrong, is we run a similar regression to the one we ran before, but instead of using the exogenous changes in reserve requirement and the exogenous part of the change in the interest rate, we use endogenous ones. And what we found is precisely that changes in endogenous reserve requirements would increase GDP. But this is precisely showing the implications of identifying things wrongly. This is precisely the result of reserve requirements being contracyclical. If a reserve requirement change is endogenous to economic activity, what this is telling us is that when GDP goes down, reserve requirements goes also down. So in that sense, reserve requirement is contracyclical. In other words, the result, the initial result we got where reserve requirements didn't affect GDP, is not because actually it did, but rather because we were using in those changes that were improperly identified, mainly endogenous cases. And because of the nature, the contracyclical nature of those reserve requirements, if you don't do this work, you could get the false impression that the reserve requirements doesn't matter, while in fact they matter in the way one would expect. Something similar, but with a different direction, occurs in terms of what happens if you use the central bank policy rate. In this case, endogenous changes in central bank would respond positively and negatively to GDP fluctuations, so it would be procyclical. This is very well known for most of our region, at least when you use historical data. Most of the time, whenever GDP was going down because capital flows were going out, because negative terms of trade, because pressures towards depreciation, what most central banks typically did was increase interest rate to try to defend the exchange rate and to avoid for the capital outflow. So in that sense, what we show here is the important implication of using this some type of a strategy. In this case, we use this well-accepted narrative strategy to identify proper shocks. So yeah, some final thoughts?
Oh yeah, okay, you have 5 minutes.
Yeah, thanks. Some final thoughts. I think this paper is very straightforward, yet a lot of work. This paper shows novel evidence about the true macroeconomic effects of macroprudential policy, identifying these reserve requirements on the macroeconomy. Our contribution is on the measurement front, but especially on the identification front. And our main findings are that if you don't things do correctly, you might get a completely misleading idea of what is going on. In this case, reserve requirements might not affect GDP or might even increase GDP. Increases in reserve requirements could increase GDP, which is very much contrary to what any of us, I guess, would have in mind when thinking about the implications of reserve requirements on the credit market. But when properly identified, we get the expected theoretical result that increases in reserve requirements would reduce economic activity, as I showed you before, through the effect on credit markets. So thank you so much. And thank you, David and Marcus, for the discussion. Look forward to hearing your thoughts and those of the audience.